just complete the give the nuances of how to do the RIRS in a stack on stones. I'll just give the what my experience over a period of last 12 years of doing this case. And finally, I'll present one case scenario of doing a complete stack on stone with a complete clearance. So far we have done more than 7,000 cases, as we explained. So total number of stack on stones were 387, and among which partial stack on was 311, and complete stack on was in 76 cases, varying from 2.8 to 7.4 centimeters. In my indications, where we choose them are usually they are discarded for PCNL, especially for associated comorbidity. If you have a stack on stone, you know, the first preference everybody would like to do is PCNL. But still, you know, there is some kind of associated comorbidity in 82% where we are going to take up for RIRS. And those patients who are on antiplatelets, I think, as you know, that there is a relatively or probably absolute contraindication for PCNL. So those are the cases we take up for the RIRS with some kind of challenges and tell them with some associated problems and may requirement of the. And after doing all this and the patient started preferring, because there is no puncture, there's no 2-3 punctures, and nowadays they are preferring to have RIRS voluntarily. What are the prerequisites? The first and foremost is clinically, you should see that the patient does not have a tenderness, in the sense there should not be any clinical evidence of infection. Urine culture should be sterile before doing any stack on RIRS. I must say one of the important criteria is a CT scan with mapping of the on-field units. I'll talk more about on this before selecting the case. And a consent, definitely a consent for single stage or a two stage or a multi-stage. If you're discarded for PCNL, we cannot do that because he is having some kind of issues. He is definitely for RIRS, but having said that, he should be understand that he requires a multi-stage procedure. And of course, a consent for accessory procedures. In my book, it is the supine PCNL, which I would like to take, and ECRIS or the other procedures as second stage, not a third stage, as an accessory procedure. And also a bit of antibiotics. You know, we know that, you know, most of the stack on stones are infected stones, and so we have a policy wherein, the depending upon the on-field unit, if it is less than 500, we are very concerned that it is maybe due to infection, so we go for a culture-sensitive antibiotic. If the culture is sterile, then we would like to go for a cefuroxime and then aminoglycoside as a first-line treatment whenever there is on-field unit is less than 500. If the on-field unit is more than 500, say about 600, 700, 800, as a regular protocol with a hospital ID guideline, we would like to go for a cefuroxime 1.5 gram before the induction. What are the requirements apart from the regular RIRS? We require a high-power holmium laser. And if you have, I think you can go for a MOSES technology. You require all the three fibers, 200, 365, and 400 for the reliability to reach all the calluses. Access sheath, what is the importance? You have to have a full access sheath of small size to big size. You have to keep it. And we require a low pressure pump irrigation system, which has been controlled. You can have it under your hand control. And a flexible scope. Preferably, I mean, there are various scopes in the market now, and so that, you know, you can easily do it with a disposable digital scope where you can do it without having any problem for about 2 to 3 hours. Other accessories in general for RIRS has to be kept on the table. So these are the accessories which you can see that some kind of access sheet here, you know, you can figure out 2 or 3 access sheets and a basket, and of course the holmium laser machine. Coming to the little detail about the access sheet, preferable is 11 to 14 access sheet. Why I mentioned that normally we don't do it behind a small access sheet in a small size. Whereas in this case, stack on stones, I am coming to the practical aspect, it's better to use 11 by 14 access sheet if it easily passable. If the access sheet is easily passable, preferable to use a new access sheet. If you're doing for a stack on stones, better to use a new one, not a reusable one, because the new has got a complete coating of that, which easily passes out in a very first time. So it's preferable to use a new 11 by 14 access sheet. If it is not possible, if you're unable to dilate it, you can use a 9.5 inch. And in the second stage, of course, if all distended, you can do with the 11 by 14 access sheet. I'll talk a little bit more about it. Coming to the choice of flexible scope, of course, nowadays there are reusable and fiber optic scope and disposable scopes. Especially digital scope, you have a good vision because you know a lot of dusting occurs in case of stag and stones. A digital scope become handy if provided if you have dilated the ureter very well. And if you have, I mean, you're going to take up this case once you have done a lot of RIRS, so possibly you would have had a flexible scope. We have all the scopes in hand, disposable scope, fiber optic scope, and digital scope. So we use a combination of this. I'll tell you how combination in what stage we use. So first stage, we use a fiber optic scope due to constraint of the size and a single use. Second stage, preferably because second stage is that the stone which you are inaccessible in the during the first stage, or you don't want to touch them during the stage, possibly the lower caliche stone. So you can use the as a second stage a disposable because of these flexibility and durability of the flexible scope. Coming to the case selection, one needs to assess the density. See, this is the right side. You can see the picture here. So highly dense, you know, in X-ray itself, and in this case, you can know that this is kind of infected stones. So preferably, you need to know whether you're going to have antibiotics. You know the culture has been given. In this case, the preference is to do a PCNL, but then you have a chance to see the bulk and other things to assess the Hounsfield unit before discarding the patients. So what do you mean by CT Hounsfield unit assessment, which I was stressing upon? One needs to have a 128 slice CT. We have been working on for the last 5, 6 years with the radiologists, sitting with them and asking them, and then they how put a software where they can really assess. This is the 721 Hounsfield units. This is a great case for RIRS. And when it increases, this case is showing around 328. I mean, in the sense, there's a square surface area. And 115, and when it reaches more than 900, we feel that it's a little tricky to do complete dusting. And in this case, it is almost like 1300 to 1400. So there is 120 slices required because to assess the, not only to assess the on-field unit, but you can map it. This is called as mapping. It's only one side is not required. Here you can see there is minimum and maximum. We have assessed the mapping of starting from top to bottom. You have seen that 167 and it's 624, and in that particular area, what is that area we calculated? We calculated about 0.37 square centimeters. So we calculate the mapping, the volume of the stone, and in particular volume, you calculate what is the Hounsfield unit. It varies, and also calculate the average Hounsfield unit in the particular stag arm stone. What is the average in that particular area, and what is the average in total overall? So we map it, we calculated it, we sit with the software with the radiologist, where all the areas of average areas, and also calculate the area square centimeters in case in the because it is directly proportional to the length into breadth into height. So that also we calculate because it's very important. You can see the in our scenario of about 1,000 more than 1,000 cases, when the Hounsfield unit is less than 1,000, the results of less than 2 centimeters is easy. In 100%, it's easy to do it. In up to 3 centimeters, it's easy to do it with a high power laser. When it crosses more than 3 to 4 centimeters, then again, still it's 87% if the Hounsfield unit is less than 1,000 and mapping the area. And when it becomes more than 5 centimeters, and in a stag arm, if there is a leg, again, less than 1,000 Hounsfield unit is almost it reaches to 79%, and you can be able to reach 97% in a second stage, especially so when you have a low Hounsfield unit, it's about 900 or 800, which I mean to say, if it is less than 1,000. The problem is with 1,000 to 1,400. Especially for up to 3 centimeters, not a problem. Issues. The problem starts with the stag arm stones, and around 3 to 4 centimeters, the stone free rate comes down because the hardness of the stone increases, although you use a high power laser. Especially in case of more than 1,400, you know that you see that the stag arm stones are very hard in the center, and then 31% drops down drastically to 31% in a first stage. But of course, it is there are a lot of stages get involved, and you need to have accessory procedures. So there is the importance of the. So what is the ideal case? Look at this stone. This is if you are done. This is a Jehovah Witness. This is the first patient which I did it about 10 years back, and this is a Jehovah Witness where blood transfusion is not supposed to do in those cases. And this is the first case which I've taken as a challenging. And then this is see the if in fact you would have punctured so many cases, and you would have. Saw that it, although it's a small bulk stones, the stag arm stones, puncturing in all these areas would have been led into a lot of blood loss. This is the Hounsfield units of 365. In the central, it was 778, and average in the pelvic, it is 900. In average, it's somewhere coming around 765 Hounsfield units, and we are able to completely clear the stone with a, this is, we did it in a low power laser. I didn't have the high power laser at that time. This is about 30 watt laser machine which I had, and I was able to complete the case with a longer pulse width. So this is the area of case where 3 months post-operative, see that the small speck is there. So 3 months later, we did about two-stage procedure. This is, and this is a final, you know, when you start with a case to do astragalus, this is an ideal case to get along with. What are the laser power settings? Is it different from regular stones? Yes, it is definitely different because you need to have to probably think about how to do the case go by. First, we have to tackle the pelvic bulk where you use 0.2 to 70 frequency with a long pulse, just the stone. You don't want to fragment at front, up front. In a pelvic stone, you want a fragmentation as minute as possible, that is dusting. So with a long pulse width, start with the dusting and then keep on increasing the pulse width, and you can go on increasing the energy 0.4 to 60 when you go to the upper calyx, and you know, when you go to the mid calyx, you can keep on increasing so that, you know, you have a much space for the stone to tackle. So, but dusting can occur only with the long pulse. It's good to have a complete minute dust so that it passes out through the access sheath. If you do a fragmentation initially in the pelvic bulk itself, these fragments go by the side of the ureter and cause a lot of problem. In fact, you will be able to, the friction and traction occurs in more of flexible scope. So if you have a contact Moses, then you have a contact and non-contact. It is a readjustable. It just adjusted the pulse weight depending upon the stone. That is the beauty of the Moses, wherein, you know, the stone dusting and you need to have to pedal the both the fragmentation dusting and fragmentation mode, and it readjusts. It's a variable pulse width. It adjusts to the short pulse width when there is a stone is hard, when you want to fragment, and it adjusts to the long pulse width when the stone is bulky. So there is an advantage, and this is the laser settings. You can go with a very low energy and high frequency is the way to go for the dusting. And these are the, when you have a pedal wherein, you know, 0.4 into 70, you can use it. And if you want a fragmentation, you can do the right pedal. And if you want to do the dusting, you can use the settings. This is one of the fair examples of the photograph, which we have done it in a few of the cases. And why this dusting protocol as a first stage? You can use this just to prevent the friction of the flexible scope by the side of the access sheath. And fragmentation of the residual stone, say about you are left behind about 1.5 centimeters of stone in the lower calyx. You can just do the fragmentation and you can do the basketing and remove it. It's preferable to have a variable combination of both dusting and fragmentation protocol, in a particularly depending upon the volume of the stone. It does not depend upon also the Hounsfield units, it depends upon the volume, because you're creating a lot of dust, creating a lot of fragmentation. You need to know what is the volume you are treating with. So what is the stages? Stages is also very important in a RIRS. You cannot claim that a single stage we can do it. 100% you have to tell the patient that it, stages is required. I say about preferably about it two stage. It's always preferable to use that. In the first stage, as I said, the dusting, middle calyx, second stage, lower remaining residual. You have to calculate and preferable to use this in a second stage, wherein you have a liberty to use a bigger access sheath, and you have the liberty to have a removal of the fragments. Preferable to between 2 weeks, 2 weeks between the two stages. Why I said 2 weeks between the two stages? Because this bulk is more. Staggering stone's bulk is more. And the dusting which you have created has to go out before you go on to this one. In one case, we have waited for about 4 to 6 weeks and the whole stone got encrusted and we are unable to remove it. And we are supposed to manage the encrusted stone, because there's a lot of dusting, a lot of fragmentation, which goes by the side of the stand and produces a lot of encrustation. So it's preferable to do 2 weeks or as soon as the fragments start passing, stops. So you see that, you know, lithuria, the patient comes with lithuria. Once it stops lithuria, when the fragmentation stops coming out, and then that is a time between 2 to 3 weeks, whichever is the earlier, that is the period to go for the second stage. Don't wait for too long, more than 2, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, 6 weeks, it gets encrustation. What are the problems? This is the common, that's what I was mentioning. Strain stress is the most commonest thing. 27% in our situation, we have faced this problem. And extravasation, yes, of course, minor.
Link connects every error.
Bleeding can happen. It's not a concern of bleeding, but some kind of bleeding is expected up to more than 72 hours in about 3 to 5
Dr. seconds. Vashne, I would request Dr. Vashne to switch off your mic, please.
Yeah. So the infection rate, again, of course, if you're taking a proper precautions, 1 to 2% vary between institution to institution. We see a lot of patients asking, I mean, a lot of young graduates asking for an infection rate in RIRS, but I think we have sorted out that problem. It is important to assess the what is the infection rate in your institution, and then it comes in episodes, you know, on a particular day, particular month, you know, one or two cases, continuously you get an infection. That's what we are facing, irrespective of the RIRS or any other procedure. And what is the other problem? Difficult to access the lower polar or some other part. You take out the main bulk and you remain behind one of the particular stone bulk, either in the lower calyx or in the upper medial calyx. There are so many calyces where you may not be able to reach it. That is also a major problem. How to tackle it? I'll just go in a few of the cases. The problems, perinephric, yeah, this is the pain. You can see that, you know, this is very commonly happens in one of the cases in the earlier stages where the case was infected. I had a completely abdominal fluid and we need to put a abdominal drain to drain that. It can happen in a staggered stage because you're concentrating morely on the stone and without giving importance for the irrigation and its drainage and all those things. So how to prevent the stenosis? Special precautions is required for these kind of cases when you're dealing with the staggered. First stage, try to tackle by the clock 60 to 70% of the bulk. As you mapped it in the CT scan, you know the bulk of the disease, tackle it 60 to 70%, leave behind 30, 35%. Use dusting protocol given in the chart. Use access sheet, bigger the better. It can be deployed very easily if it is, can be deployed. Otherwise, you have no choice. You have to use a small sheet. Remove the flexible scope to clear the fragments every 10 to 15, this is a very important point because that's the reason I said when you're fragmenting, you keep on fragmenting. The fragments tend to come out because the stone cannot go anywhere else because it's a staggered, it's blocking. It is coming out towards you, towards the access sheet by the side of the, on either side of the flexible scope. So it tends to collect there and you won't be able to move on it. At times, I faced a problem where I was unable to remove even the flexible scope. So these are the situations if you stay for long. Every 10 minutes, you just bring down, withdraw the flexible scope, all the fragments clears out, irrigation clears out, and keep the irrigation at 10 to centimeters apart with the intermittent flow so that the irrigation and with the, if you have a bigger access sheet, then that's a very good flow, then you can keep on removing the sheath of flexible scope for a period of about 20, 25 minutes. So again, that important is that 2 week to 2 weeks, the duration. This is the intraoperative and this is postoperatively. You can call back the patient after 2 weeks for the prevention of the incrustation. So how to use it? This is the almost the chest sheath has gone all the way up to the near of the, and you can see the fluid, which I'm trying to show. When you're doing that, you've got a virus edge, this is a 11 by access sheet. And when you are fragmenting it, the fragments are coming out, the irrigation is coming out. This can prevent the strain stress, this can prevent the extravasation of the urine. This is one very, very important that you know, your access sheet is properly in place and up inside the almost near towards the pelvis. So difficult lower pole. So you tackle, this is a case of partial staggered where you know, you tackle all these things and you may not be able to tackle the, this is a very high density stone. This is somewhere around 1,400 or 1,500. We are able to tackle this stone and we are seeing only the length. We are not seeing the breadth and height. This case is also has a problem wherein you need to access the procedure. In such cases where you have a patient has been told that this patient requires some kind of accessory procedure. You can see that here we are simultaneously doing that procedure, doing an RIRS, and sometimes the bulk is more. It's also helpful. We have placed a pre-placed in a supine position, ultrasound-guided puncture into the lower calyx. We pre-placed a mini park, 12 mm access. You can see that sometimes earlier we used to put access sheet. Now we are placing that mini park. So we pre-placed a puncture in the lower calyx. It gives a two important help. One is to drain out the fragment when you're doing simultaneously, you're doing a flexible scope. This is the ECRS, which we do it regularly. We explain this patient because it will be very small puncture we may require. And then so that it will helpful in two things. One is to drain out the fragment while doing the antegradely. And also the if you anticipate the lower calyceal, then that also can be tackled out simultaneously. This you should be, one should be prepared to tell the patient that you require some kind of accessory procedure like this. So this is the where, you know, simultaneous procedure showing that and the same position we usually do a little lateral tilt and these are the same stack on stones. So inaccessible calyx, you can go and tackle it along with a flexible scope. This will reduce it because this is a very small puncture and the blood loss is very less. But I think in our overall procedure, in 18% is the accessory procedure in about 993 cases. 18% of them. So we are better prepared to tell the patient what is the percentage of accessory procedure. In a staggered stones, we have about 9%. wherein we tell them that this is the chance of 91% of the time we are able to complete the case. Now I'm going to present a case scenario wherein we try to see what how we went and did this case of a large stone. This is a 76 years bilateral flank pain and left more than the right since 2 weeks. He had a dysuria, anuria, fever. He's a 76 years, diabetes, hypertension, severe and antiplatelets. He underwent somewhere else in the right RIRS. They did a perfect job there. And then since he was a high-risk patient, so they did a DJ stenting on the left side because he was infected, he had a fever. So they put a DJ stenting. And he would come for a follow-up, and he had not gone for a follow-up. And later on, he went there. And they wanted to explain him the procedure for about the PCNL, which with all the risk, second stage patient was explained. He was not agreeable. So then the patient voluntarily said, please remove the stent. So they tried to remove the stent. Right side, they were able to do it. Left side, they couldn't remove it. So after 6 weeks, he wanted to get rid of it because he didn't want to undergo the procedure with a lot of complications, PCNL. So started having amaturia. And then he came to me with the status of retained left digit stent, post-PTCA status, and concerned about the issues which is going. So we took up this challenge and see, this is the X-ray which we had come in. This is a Stegham stone with a retained stent there. He's unable to remove the stent. And the right side stent was there, and they placed one more stent, and then we went and cleared the right side, and this procedure, this patient underwent a CT scan. We did a fresh CT scan, which approximately is about 5.3 centimeters length, and also we have had a mapping of this case. Bilateral digit stent with the pigtail was in the PR. We are able to assess that. So we did a CT scan mapping. We sat with the radiologist and found that there's somewhere around the average of 926, which was incredibly good. And very low area of square centimeters, let's say about 13 to 14 square centimeters, if I remember vaguely, because most of the square centimeters are almost 92 square centimeters of stone was about somewhere around 900 to 800. Only a few square centimeters, say about 13, 14, if I vaguely remember, it's about 1448 of the Hounsfield units. So we took up the challenge with telling the patient we may require two stage or he may require a three stage. And this is the video I'm showing that I'm just run this video. This is the bulk and we've mapped it. Usually they map it this is the CT scan with a stent in place, with the left stag on, a right DJ stent in place. Hope the video is running properly there. And we went and tried to remove the cystoscopically, try to remove the stent. We couldn't remove the stent. We passed a ureteroscope by the side of the stent. And there were a lot of encrustation of the stones. See the bulk of the stones. This was, of course, they kept for about, this is about 6 weeks after the stenting. So we placed a wire and see that the stent was pushed upwards and it was encrusted and it was unable to remove it. We have to pass a ureteroscope and then tackle the stones. And then after that, we placed a extra sheath because the stent was not coming out. We have to put a wire and place an axial sheath. This time we are able to place about 11 by 14 axial sheath. This is an axial sheath we placed, very good adaptable axial sheath. And see, we didn't use a guide wire here. This is very adaptable and very clear. And the stone is starting from the upper ureter itself. So we used a high power. In this case, we had a both choice of, because I didn't want it to take a chance, I used a Moses in this case. It's not always mandated to use that because this case was high risk and I didn't want to take chance. This is the power, it was 0.2 into 70 with the Moses effect with the 14 watts. And believe me, that fragmentation was simply excellent. You can see that there's a dusting. This is the dusting protocol which we started with 0.2 into 70 and keep on increasing. And also at the same time, we usually at the 10 to 12 centimeters of irrigation is sufficient so that we are able to see the good fragmentation, good dusting. It's not getting bigger fragments. So we are able to follow up with the CM frequently, see that whether the, because there's still the stent is upwards and still that stent was not coming out. Our main first aim was to remove the stent, set that to clear that. So we are able to pass that stone all the way up into the pelvis and then pelvic bulk has been tackled out. We slowly increase now. Now we increase the fragmentation because we saw the fragmentation was coming out through the axial sheath. The dusting was coming out, so we were comfortable. See that this little bit of more fragmentation start happening now. What you saw about 0.2 and 70, and now 0.4 and 70, little of more bigger fragmentation started happening, although the complete bigger fragments are not there. So these fragments, we saw that. It's a continuous, it's a dynamic process. You saw the, what are the fragments coming out, and then start increasing the energy levels. It's not a hard and fast rule that you should do that. But then, you know, it gives a complete leverage to use that if you have that machine kind of thing. So we went ahead and were trying to find out the C loop of the DJ stent. It was very, although a little of editing has been taking place in this. So see that the coil of the DJ stent is there now. This is into within 20, 25 minutes of the procedure, we were able to get into the loop of the stent where it has got incrustation. There's also a big stone which is sitting over that, and we started fragmenting that. So this is slowly, slowly increasing the, this is a, I'll just fast forward this as it is. And then we are able to see that the fragmentation effect, and there is, you can see that the fragmentation is coming towards the flexible scope and onto the access sheet, so that, and see that now we are able to remove the stent. So this is the first bulk of the patient. Throughout the procedure, you saw that there was not much of bleeding as such. And then we are able to place the, replace the access sheet, see that the amount of fragments which are coming towards the access sheet. So it's just floating towards it. Please put the irrigation a little bit over a period of time so that the irrigation will drive away the, see the, look at the fragmentation in the upper portion of the pelvis and upper portion. We tackle the planned it like that. You know, we tackle only the upper pole and the pelvics. See that we have not gone into the lower calyx. We gone into the pelvis and then into the upper calyx. And then we just turn on towards the mid calyx. This is just that, you know, effect is, we have seen that effect. I'm just fast forwarding the effect. You can see that the stone does not, it's not a classical lateral movement which stays. It is a little advantage of the stone not moving too much. Of course, with the irrigation, the stone definitely moves. But if you stop the irrigation, the stone does not move, but you know, the irrigation, the vision will not be great. So this is the amount of dusting what we are getting it through that. Completely, I was able to do the dusting protocol in this with the mid pole and upper pole, and we are able to see the appropriate calyces with the appropriate small fragmentation. These are about almost, this is a 265 micron, which I'm using it. And you are able to see that there are very, very small fragments. And we are trying to see that we are able to reach the stone into this area. So this is the lower calyceal bulk, which you are able to see. And we thought that probably we can try and do some fragmentation of the lower calyx also. But this is only the tip of the iceberg, where we saw the little tip, and but then main bulk of the lower calyx was still present. But of course, you can see that the fragmentation is very clear, and it's doable. It's not that. And then when we know that we are clear about the pelvis, we know that we are clear about the upper calyx, and we saw that this is the lower calyceal visualization, and then whatever the fragment which is there, we just cleared it out, and then we just came out, and then we put a stent. So we didn't tackle the lower calyceal by the clocks. You can see that the stone there, lower calyx. We came out after 4 weeks in this case, because the patient, although I said 2 weeks in this patient, the bypass, this is after 4 weeks, the CT scan. We placed a pre-placed stent, there was some amount of air in the kidney, and this is the lower calyceal stone. This was the only stone, and some little fragments in the middle calyx. So we pre-planted, then he was passing a lot of fragments. So we waited for that. And we know that one, if we have to tackle some kind of strain stress, we removed the stent, and we went again with our ureteroscope, and we tackled the small stones. Usually they see that this is the strain stress. These are the, some fragments which were there. And we just went and removed with a rigid forceps and clear all the stone fragments so that, you know, you can easily replace the access sheet. So just cleared, and then put a new access sheet. Where is clear, put an access sheet. Now this is also a 11 by 14 access sheet. Sometimes we also use 14, 16 access sheet if it is easily doable, and then do a contrast study at that level to find out if there's any problem. The contrast study shows very intact PCS, and then only in the lower calyceal stone bulk. this is what, and after 4 weeks later, and then we went with the, this time we didn't use any Mohs fiber, we use a regular non-Mohs because the cost of the laser fiber, I mean, you know that it's a single-use Mohs fiber, so we didn't want it to, this is a small bulk, so we thought that we'll not use the Mohs fiber. In this case, we use a non-Mohs laser fiber. It's a reusable, we usually about 40 to 50 times we use that fiber, so this is the lower calcium stone which we have seen there. That all the areas are seems to be very clear, and see this fiber is non-Mohs kind of fiber, and this stone seems to be a little harder than what it was seen, probably because of the laser effect which has been shown up here. And this is the stone man just went and did the procedure completely, and few of the fragments, in this case our aim is to completely clear the stone, so we started removing the fragments. So in this setting, we did a fragmentation setting so that we don't want to leave behind the dusting. So we made a fragmentation of the sizable fragment. We know that about 30-40 pieces, we passed 30-40 passes into the kidney, removed them easily because we had a sheath so that we don't have to bother about the dusting and getting in encrusted sometimes later. And also on table, usually confirm this by doing a on table and supine position ultrasound. We confirm that by doing the flexible scope. We confirm that on the ultrasound to find out if there's any stone fragments are remaining and things like that, so that the complete clearance has been confirmed, because if there is any inaccessible calyx, we might try to access it, so that it's a simultaneous procedure of ultrasound. And this is one of the prerequisite to see that, you know, you're not left behind the some of the stagnant stones, because even if you've been a small stone, this is the post-operative film after 2 weeks later. This is complete clearance. This is a complete clearance because it's very important in a stagnant stone that you're not dealing with even leaving behind a small stone, so it will recurrence. So this patient had a very old age situation, so we are able to tackle this. So these are some of the cases we have tackled in such cases of, we assess the tonsil unit and also mapping of the stone, and then use the judiciously use the high power lasers. So far, we have done about 7,083 cases. You can see that the patients requiring the second stage keep on increasing. And in the stratum stones, we have about 3.6% of them, and 91% with a stone free rate of 89% in a second stage. Some of them also required a third stage procedure. But of course, we have done about varying degrees of diverticulum also, anomalous kidney also. Today's concentration is on the stagon. So up to 2.5 centimeters, no issues. When there's around 3 centimeters, depending on the tonsil units, show that first stage itself, we are about 57% of the time, it requires a second stage. When it becomes more than 4 centimeters, definitely second stage is required in almost 90% of the time. So we plan them as a two-stage procedure and do it. And requiring any alternate ECRS or supine PCNLs are more common in lower pole calyx because of the inaccessibility. This is common there, requiring ECRAs or supine PCNL during the same time. And it's also, it's comparable with the stagon stones in a very small compact system. It's about 9% of the time. So thank you. I think I made myself very clear, and I will check up your questions if there's any.
Oh, thank you, Dr. Manohar. What a wonderful and lucid presentation. And I think
thank you.
There hardly any thing you left unexplained. But still, there are lots and lots of questions for you, and people are really looking forward to having some of them answered. I think one of the commonest questions which they are asking is, what is there a time limit to which you would conduct the PCNL? For example, you start the PCNL and say you spend only about 90 minutes on the stone, and then you postpone it to a second stage or some such thing. Is there any kind of time limit which you offer to the patient?
I fix up a time limit if I am unable to put an access sheath. Okay. If I'm unable to put access sheath, I put a time limit, because I also do without access sheath. Sometimes, you know, the patient is there where I'm unable to put access sheath, I pass a flexible scope by the side of the wire, and it's a tight situation where the ureter and flexible scope are in tight connection. Whatever the fluid you're putting, it is not coming out. There, I put a fix up a time limit for about 60 minutes. I don't go behind that. Whenever there is no access sheath, I put a time limit. Otherwise, if there is access sheath, if the flow is good, if the vision is not great, 1.5 hours, and a planning of the bulk. My main aim is to bulk. If I'm able to clear 70% of the bulk within 1 hour, fine. If I'm able to complete the 70% of the bulk in the first stage itself, about 1.5 hours, 2 hours, no problem.
Very nice. Okay, another question by Dr. Wahid Zaman is, what is the incidence of sepsis that you face in your series, and how do you prepare for that? Is there
Yeah, this is because this question is goes every time when I present RIRS. Let me tell you, I've crossed about 7,000 now. Initially, when I started in 2007, the first 100 cases, we had 27%. 27%. Okay. Today, the last chart showing about less than 2%.
Okay.
I think there is some lot of issues we tend to take very aggressively, but that's what I mentioned, tenderness of the kidney, infection is there. Subclinical infection, culture may be negative. Culture may be negative, but when you palpate the kidney, then there is some kind of tenderness is there. So the subclinical infection, we lose out on those. We don't give appropriate antibiotic. And then possibly what happens to get the vision, we put a lot of pressure, a lot of system, mm-hmm. Irrigation system is too much. And then also this, it became a closed system. You have tend to struggle to put access sheath. You tend to use a overuse 40 times, 50 times overuse access sheath. It does not fall into place. Some kind of tear occurs. You put a high irrigation, extravasation occurs. These are all multifactorial. I don't say a single factor. In the initial learning curve, one should be very careful, assess everything together, whatever the point I mentioned, it can reduce. And what right now we have infection is only related to infection rate within the hospital. All the surgical mode, they say that infection, surgical site infection, that is a time where we are having. Per se, we are not bothered about infection at all now.
So what is the type of irrigation you like to use in such cases?
I mean, I usually use the Nadiad irrigation, which pump irrigation, which was innovated about 10, 15 years when I was there during that period of my residency. This, although it's 10 to 12 centimeters, it's a foot control, and then irrigation is keep on going because you are free. One hand is free and left hand, you have to move the flexible in and out. So preferable to have a three-way so that, you know, irrigation is, although it is going 10 to 12 centimeters, you don't want to go continuously. You have to have a three-way under your hand control. Whenever there is a dust occurs, you can just release the irrigation and stop it. So it's a three-way control irrigation system. There are a lot of people use the hand and there's a load of irrigation is there. When you start the procedure, you get used to certain irrigation system, see that the irrigation flow is coming out, especially in case of staghorn stones, if you're venturing.
Right.
Regular stone, I'm not worried about, you can get away with that.
So there's a question from Dr. Syed Sajid Nazir, and he wants to know, how do you select the length of access sheath that you're going to use in a particular case?
Yeah, I mean, there is, you need not have to use a very long length because it dangled down over the penile area, preferably about 20, 35 is the maximum length we choose it. 45, it just goes if it's a very lengthy, 6 centimeters. One of the German guys was a 6'3", I have to use a 45 centimeters access sheath. But the more the access sheath, the more it dangles into the bladder. So preferably use about 35 centimeters for a male, 27 centimeters for the female.
Thanks. So, Pan, sir.
Okay, so is there any particular sterilization protocol you follow for your flexible instruments? Or...
Yeah, we always do plasma.
Okay.
Plasma.
And you're using which kind of a scope for this? You have the disposable one?
We have both a flexible reusable scope and then disposable scopes. We have all of them in the kitty. So mostly if it is a large stone and if you want to play a long duration, if you want to go into the lower calyx, we use a disposable scope. If you don't want to tackle the difficult stone cases, we use a fiber optic scope.
Okay.
Manohar, sir, can I ask a question?
Come on, Aditya.
Yes, Dr. Taneja.
Yes, Aditya. Sir. Aditya.
Yeah. So my question, Manohar, is... Hi. So, Manohar, it was wonderful presentation. I wanted to know
Sir, your voice is breaking.
What is the incidence of ureteric injury?
Yeah.
Not really to mention about. I didn't mention in my injury. I mean, it's probably an overstatement. We have seen injuries. They're all grade one injuries. I haven't come across with a stricture of the ureter wherein it requires intervention.
Dr. Aditya, you want to?
Yeah, Aditya, please go ahead.
Yeah, so one is Staghorn stone itself are known to harbor a lot of infection and bacteria.
Correct, correct.
So having a closed system, despite having a largest size possible sheath, it will continue to be a high pressure system compared to a mini perk. And second part of the question is, like you're already very comfortable with supine perk and ECIRS. So one procedure which could have been completed in one sitting, we are taking it to two or three sittings. So is it a good idea?
That's what I showed you the video. When I do ECRIS, I take always the consent. I don't know whether you were there in the initial presentation. I always take consent for ECRIS because I'm able to do it with ultrasound guided puncture and do it. See, these are the cases which I'm choosing. Given the choice, whatever the stone I did it, it's not my first choice to do RIRS. This is the case of patient, the bulk of the patients who are high risk with high comorbidity, where you cannot even venture PCNL, where the patient has come with antiplatelets. There are a lot of patients in, you know, of course, 45 years in Bangalore, I think 50% of them are taking ecosprin. These are the cases where they are on dual antiplatelets, undergone some valvular surgery. High risk patients only have been chosen. These are not simple straightforward case. Since we have done this case, the patients are preferring. Now they don't want any puncture. In Bangalore, the scenario is different. I don't know how it is going to there. Nobody wants a puncture here. Even a small puncture, they are very resistant. So since I'm branded to have certain, I mean, I have an edge over the other things that they know they want me to do only RIRS only. But having said that, I don't give them 100% confidentiality that I'm going to do it. Preferably, I use the ECRS with the smallest mini perk in accessible colleagues. So it also, simultaneously, helps in drainage of the stones. That's what I was trying to tell. Regarding the access sheath, I mean, regarding the closed system, we always use access sheath. It's a must in Staghorn stones. It's a bigger sheath. That's our reason. So either we do it 40% in the first stage and use the second stage bigger sheath so that the flow is very good. In case, if we have found that the store is having a lot of infected material, that also case we pass a ECRS small scope into the kidney system and we drain it out. That is also a standby. In 9%, we have done this. So that is what I'm trying to tell. It's in a single stage only we are trying to do that, but the risk is high. In such cases, we use, selectively we use the ECRS with the smallest mini puck.
Thank you. So, sir, in your routine practice.
Yeah.
In your routine practice, the patient gives you an option. What is your upper limit when you decide that I'll go for a mini PCNL or a PCNL? Or, I mean,
in my OPD, patient comes want to come and get RIRS only.
No, sir. Patient leaves the option on you.
Yeah.
Doctor, whatever you think is best for me, I will do it. And so, what is your upper limit for RIRS for such patients?
Yeah. The upper limit of RIRS is 3 centimeters, irrespective of the Hounsfield unit.
Okay.
If the on-field unit is, my criteria is with the on-field unit only, if the on-field unit is 1,400 and 3 centimeter stone, say about 1,400 and 3 centimeters, I'll tell them I'll do a mini perk. First choice is mini perk.
Right.
Because it's going to state the procedure, I'll tell him I can completely clear the stone with a mini perk in a single stage. But if you want RIRS, be prepared for the two stage. So on-field unit will drive my...
You mentioned great points about mapping the stone and seeing the different on-field unit. I think that is something we all should incorporate in our practice.
You give the on-field unit of 900 and you go in and you see it, and you are unable to break the stone.
Yes.
It is always common. And 64 slice CT cannot give. You need to have a 128 and above. 128 slice CT is, when we started, we started calling with radiologists and then they upgraded. And also in 128 slice CT, there is some software upgrading system. I forgot that name. So they have upgraded system so that they are able to give the proper mapping and average on-field unit, the overall stone, so that we are confident of doing that.
Okay, Dr. Madhur, can you talk something about what is the MOSES technology and how it is different from the conventional lasers, and about the MOSES technology?
Yeah.
And how it is different from the conventional lasing, and what are the kind of settings? You had one slide which you discussed, or you actually mentioned the settings which were there, but there are many questions about what kind of settings you are using and what exactly is MOSES technology.
So the laser system revolves around the pulse width, pulse duration. We know that there is a energy and frequency. You will keep on varying the energy and frequency depending upon the stone composition. And if the stone is very hard, you try to increase the energy. But in a pulse width, if you apply the pulse width, that is the nanometer, that is the duration of the pulse width. Say we vary from 125 to 1,500 microseconds. It's in microseconds. What does it mean? What do I mean by 500 pulse width microsecond? Tuck, tuck, tuck. What is it? 1200. Tuck, tuck, tuck. That means the duration of the laser falling on the stone is the duration is increased. That means the energy dissipation is slowly and happening, and so it causes small dust. Tuck, 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 produces fragmentation. It breaks the stone because the stone contains 10% of water. So water explodes. This is the normal system. The water explodes. When the laser falls on, heat created, bubbles forms, and the stone explodes. This is the classical scenario of your stone fragmentation. And when you increase the pulse width, this forms a dusting. Now, what is MOSES? In this, the stone fragmentation is, again, it is encased in a bubble technology, wherein the stone has continuously banked to produce the stone fragmentation. And also, it can be done with a non-contact mode. And it is a variable pulse width. You need not have to adjust. Regular case, I adjust with a 500 pulse width, 700 pulse width. In a MOSES, it adjusts. It's a variable pulse width. It adjusts to the variable pulse width so that you can go for a non-MOSES or MOSES. When you do a MOSES, it's a bubble in bubble. It's an entrapment of the stone. If you stop the irrigation, the stone does not move. Basically, the stone moves because of the irrigation. So that is the fallacy of, you know, every time you see in a conference, the stone starts moving. But the fallacy is that in a regular stone, if the stone moves, whereas in MOSES, if the irrigation is stopped, the stone does not move. But it's very difficult to do without the irrigation. So you can do MOSES non-contact mode. You can stay at about 1 centimeter away in a lower calyx. You bend it. You see the stone in a non-contact mode. You can do the stone. That's the beauty of the MOSES non-contact mode. You can do the contact mode. You can do a fragmentation. Whereas those reliability, the flexibility is not there in regular pulse width lasers. This is just a variable pulse width laser system.
There's a question from Dr. Sudas.
Yeah.
And he wants to know, do you tilt the table in any direction during RIRS? And does it help in any way?
Get more access.
Correct. See, earlier I used to do that for, this is specifically for lower calyx, most medial. It is accessibility itself is about 6%. You cannot access them at all.
Yes.
So in such cases, you know, we make a tilt like this. I push the kidney upwards. You put irrigation, you put a basket. All those maneuvers can be done for a lower calyceal, small stones. There's a manuated stone. They are moving and they are not able to reach it. So in such situation, it may help, but then, you know, it depends. I mean, the position per se for a lower calyceal, I mean, an upper calyx, I don't think that's not required. Only the lower, most medial calyx is a problem. So that you can use little of tilt, it can be used.
Vashni sir wants to comment.
Yeah, Manohar, I'm really happy to see your presentation, and you have become an expert in this tag on stones, as well as your counseling, case selection, everything. As you keep doing cases, you become master of that. But we always train our residents and people with us, and the biggest question is about the number of scopes you use in a year, or so to say, the damage to the flexible scopes and the place of digital scopes in your armamentarium. Because today we have this digital armamentarium also available, but there is time limit. So how many cases you can safely do with them? And as a mentor to the youngsters, would you take the reusable scope as a modality?
So there are two things now, fiber optic scope and a reusable. If you are doing a flexible scope now, I think the bulk is more, it's better to have both together in your kitty. And regarding the usage in my hand, so I've been the first case, I broke the scope within 23 case. The second scope I broke within 76 case. After 200 case, 1,326 we did it, and I got one free from Carl Stores as a souvenir. 356 cases in one scope, single use. So even today, in average, if I use a single scope, only Miami, I'm able to complete 150 cases in a fiber optic scope. Now we have about 7-member team in my team. Everybody uses it. We have an average of 72 cases, and they are all trained. 72 cases, multi-users, 72 cases, fiber optic scope is the fiber optic scope. Now, where do you use this disposable scopes? Disposable scopes are used when you are expecting a stagon stone, infected stones, And when you're doing link with the lower calcium stones and the larger bulk stones, because you know that the time limit is there and it is a sterile environment, you got a new scope, and where you cannot access, because in a fiber optic scope, you want to go into the lower calyx, you may have a fear that you're going to break the scope, but that does not happen in disposable scopes. So you can use that in a, especially in a lower calcium stones, you can use that in a larger bulk stone, and you can use them in a infected case scenarios.
Would you like to give some tips to the youngsters to prevent the damage to the scope? Because that is very important.
Prevent the damage to the ureter.
To the ureter scope.
Yeah. I think pre-dilatation of the ureter, if you are able to dilate the ureter up to 14 French, I think that's the way to do it. If you are unable to dilate the ureter, better to pre-place a stent and come back at the second stage. That will definitely 100% will prevent the the damage to the ureter. And in your initial cases, better to use a new access sheath, about 4 to 5 cases. Don't, when you become an expert, then you can increase it to 40 cases. So it is the passage of the access sheath. Up to 4 or 5 cases, the slimy coating over the access sheath is so good. And you need not have even to dilate. You can just wax in. So that is the one of the tip for the youngsters who can start doing the cases.
So what is your preferred method of dilatation of ureter?
If you ask me, I don't dilate the ureter.
Yeah, because you...
And I usually do a fixed range ureteroscopy.
Yeah.
And then put a visual dilatation rather.
Yeah.
And if it is a difficult case scenario like this, Stragan stones, and we explain the patient in detail regarding the cast, and I use a brand new access sheet, I see that, if it is used second time, third time usage, I just put a straight away dilatation. If it is not possible, then I do a serial dilatation. Using a dilator, serial ureter dilators, we use it. Up to 12 French, it should cross the iliac bifurcation. It should cross the iliac bifurcation up to 12 French. That means I'm sure that 9x11 sheath, access sheath, will pass behind the iliac bifurcation. Because if it go below the iliac bifurcation, it drops down, it dangles into the ureter.
Right.
Yeah, just Washington, I want to know that is Stag-Horn stones, by nature, they are low Hounsfield unit. Many a times when you have low Hounsfield stags, they could be simply putty-like material or matrix stones, or it could be fungal balls, or you can have infection inside the stone, and then it could be coated with all infected material and matrix. So if you encounter these kind of situations, do you change the strategy or you pursue with it?
No, this is, I think, it is not a surprise for us, because we are sitting with radiologist to find out the on-field unit, and we'll come to whether it is a fungal material or a putty material. I will not venture into RIRS at all in such situation. There is no question of me going there and then change my mind, because in most of the occasion, with the mapping of the on-field unit, and we are able to know that exactly, because you get some kind of acoustic shadowing in within the mass itself. Those are the cases where we prefer to do a PCNL to remove that, because it's a closed system, infection rate will be very high, and it is not a case to do an RIRS. Although we do it as a second stage in a papillary retrieval, but the infected stone with some kind of situation like this, I think my first preference is to do a PCNL rather than RIRS.
So, Pan sir, you want to take the next question?
One of the questions is, are you using pre-stenting?
In my experience, 95% of the time, we don't use. We are able to tackle the course, because with sheath, without sheath, with wire, without wire, whichever is possible, we do it. Our aim is to complete the procedure in 95% of the time. Having said that, we take a consent in 5% of the situation where the ureter is tight, we are unable to pass any of the scope. We just place a 6x26 DJF stenting, we place it. And also we'll tell them if it is not really agreeable for the staging, we do a mini PERC or convert them immediately in a supine PCNL. We just go ahead and do it. So in 5% of the situation only, we require a stenting.
There's a question from Dr. Kamlesh. There are a lot of questions. So far, there are 102 questions, sir. So we have to...
fast you can. I can just go fast then.
There's a question from Dr. Kamlesh that if there's an infundibular stenosis and you have to give an incision, what is the energy setting that you like to use?
So this is the energy setting wherein you need to... I usually very, very low setting with a long pulse weight, about 0.2. into 1 energy and 0.2 into 8 energy. And this is only mucosal cuts. It's a 4-point mucosal cut. If there's infundibular stenosis, It is not one cut above and one cut below. It's a 4-point only mucosal infusions has to be given. Use a very, very 0.8. You can start from the energy and you can go up to one maximum, because especially in the upper infundibulum, I would not go venture because there's some kind of accessory vessels. Middle calyx is able to do it. Lower calyx infundibulotomy is very, very difficult.
We'll take this last question because we're about to run out of time. So Dr. Arif Hamid wants to know, what is your experience in management of stones in calyceal diverticulum using such technique?
Yeah, we are closely about 92 cases of calyceal diverticular stones. I mentioned that. What is the experience they want? They want to know.
Yeah, how comfortable are you with RIRS for calyceal diverticulum stones?
Yeah, if it is in the upper calyx and a middle calyx, if you are able, upper calyx is the most comfortable one. We have tackled that very often so that we are able to do a mucosal incision and do it. Middle calyx, at times, if you're able to identify the opening, they are able to do it. Otherwise, lower calyceal diverticulum cannot be managed at all. It has to be in alternative methods. So the basic thing is to identify the opening. We usually use a methylene blue test, and then usually somehow the 60% of them are upper calyceal diverticulum with the stone. So we are able to tackle them easily. Some kind of mucosal membrane is the one common we find it. Very rarely you find a big infundibular neck. Most of them, my series, in 92 cases, about 40 of them are having a mucous membrane kind of thing. So we are able to pass a methylene blue and find out the opening, and then we are able to open up the mucosa and then tackle it.